A sultry singer and actress, Sarah Dash is mostly known as a member of the Labelles, with Patti Labelle and Nona Hendryx. Born in Trenton, New Jersey, Dash has returned home to reconnect with her roots. She is releasing a new gospel album, her first in fact, and is starring in a one-woman show in New York City. I sat down with this legend to find out what she's been up to since leaving the spotlight.
Sarah Dash, it's an honor.
Thank you.
As I was riding on the train here, I'm singing in my head, what can I do for you? What can you do for me? You know,
yes.
That song that you sung so famously that I remember with the Labelles and so many others. Talk about your history with the Labelles. You started out born and raised here in Trenton, New Jersey.
Where we are now.
Where we are now. Sort of like a back to now.
Yes.
The title of your reunion
that
cover.
That was the title of the reunion CD, yes.
And so how did you get involved with singing?
I started singing as a child, right here in Trenton, at a church called the Trenton Church of Christ. My father was a minister there. He had been a member since the 40s, and I was always involved in the church with youth choir. I would sing, and I remember I was kind of strange back then, but because if I didn't feel like singing, there was nothing they could do to make me sing. But eventually I got past that. But I actually started singing in the church, which led to singing solos in school for, you know, Thanksgiving program. And I remember the first time a teacher heard me sing. I was all in the second grade, and I was singing. She's like, we're going to put her in a program. And I remember the other teacher saying, she's too little, she's too young. She said, I guarantee you she will, you know, do this. And I remember the song as if it was yesterday. It's called With These Hands. And there I was singing. My mom was giving these curls, and they told me, you can't itch and you can't scratch when you're singing. You can't do, you know. And why did they tell me that? Because on that day, everything was itching me. And I remember singing With These Hands, but they told me I can't scratch my head, and I continued to sing, and the people went crazy, you know. But that's where I started as a child.
And somehow you ended up in Philadelphia with Nona Hendryx. And you
Nona is from Trenton, New Jersey, too. Actually, Nona's in the business because of me. Nona was singing at her mother's church one Sunday, and there was a girl who dropped out of our group, and we needed a low voice. And Nona sang, she said that was the only solo she ever sang in her life, and that was the Sunday our choir came as well. And I said, let's go get that girl, Nona Hendryx, and get her to sing with us. And that's how Nona got into business, you know.
Amazing. And the connection with Patti Labelle, how did that happen?
We had the same manager. He managed two groups, the Del Capris and the Ordettes. So when people from Patti's group left, and they left for my group, he put us together, and we became the Bluebelles. The early days, there was a lot of stardust, that's what I call it, because we had people to think about our future. We didn't think about a future. We had no business, you know, training or anything like that. And it was just fun. I mean, our first show being at the Apollo with Benny King and, you know, the Drifters and people like that. We didn't really think about it. All we knew we were going to be on the stage. We didn't think about future anything. We had parents that looked after us to make sure, you know, what we were doing. At that time, we weren't making the kind of money you make today. And I'm not sure if we were making enough money back then. But, no, I didn't think about anything pertaining to a future. It was like, oh, we're... See, in my experience, because my mom kept me in loafers and things like that, it was very Ivy League growing up with plaid skirts and long bobby socks and things like that. So now I'm 15 and I get to wear high heels and a party dress. Oh, I was in.
How did the business affect your personal life?
The business, my personal life was the business, if you can get what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
When I went home, came off the road, Well, it affected me in the sense that I behaved in a totally different way when I was home, because you're out on the road, you're eating restaurant food, you know, eating out all the time, you're talking all the time. It gave me a spirit of wanting to read and I was always an extrovert, but I became very introverted when I was home. I wanted quiet time. I went out a lot when I was younger, but I still wanted that place when I was off the road. And I would sometimes go back to some of the cities that I'd been to just to see what the city is about. You know, can you imagine being in Paris and all you're doing are television shows and interviews and you don't get to see any of these things. And I've gone back, you know, to do that personally, you know. But it affected, it's like you don't have, it's like how do you go on vacation? Your work is your vacation when you're in the industry because you get to travel different places. So it's like what is personal is where your heart and, you know, your vision goes. That's the personal side of you, how you think, the choices you make. So wanting to be a success in the business, you're driven, which that thing comes home because your manager comes home. Everybody comes home with you, even though they're not physically there. They're still in your home because you have to pick up that phone and talk about what you're doing. So, you know, personal, business, you know, you have a baby, you have whatever. It's all in the press. Where do you personalize? How do you do that? You don't when you're in the industry.
And I think it's sometimes difficult for the public or your fans to see the person behind the television screen.
Yeah, it would be very hard for them. Some people think you should wake up with the LaBelle costumes when you come in to a room. You know, and there are some people who are just that naive to think that you would wear stage clothes all the time. Yet, on the other hand, there are some people who don't leave their home unless they're da-da-da-da-da-da-da. You know, but as you see, I'm sitting here today, I'm not wearing half the makeup I wear on stage. And I never do wear, I put a little bit on for you today because I didn't want to shock you, I mean.
And you look great.
Thank you.
So to the point of reinventing yourself and rebranding yourself, you're doing that, and you have one-woman shows. You sort of branched out into philanthropy. You speak out for political campaigns.
Yes.
Is it difficult rebranding yourself and reintroducing yourself to new genres and venues that people, like on a political scene, most people aren't used to seeing you talk about politics and candidates?
This is true.
So is that difficult, rebranding yourself?
No, it's not even about rebranding. It's your own personal interest in what you are concerned about in life. I'm very much concerned about what our politicians are doing in America. I'm very supportive of Obama. He stepped into a problem that he didn't create, and yet there are some small-minded people running around saying, look what Obama did. How dare you? You had a president for 8 years who created an atmosphere in America. And Obama came in, and less than a year, you were saying this is what he did. America, what is wrong with you? Don't you know you made that choice? You chose Obama because of what had been created in America and the downspill of what, you know, the economic situation, employment, the education situation, how they were doing things. How dare you not see that this man did not create these problems that he has set himself in the position to take care of, and they're not giving him a chance. You know, the rhetoric of these people who do the news. I mean, it's the whole propaganda, you know, how we create the mind thought. It's the same thing with the record. If you keep playing it over and over again, you hate it when you first hear it. But if you hear it 10 times, you find yourself singing it. That's what they've done.
Now, is a political career for yourself in the future? Will we see Sarah Dash running for the Trenton City Council?
That sounds really exciting, but I don't know if I want all the doors open in my life.
I would imagine you get a lot of support.
I probably would. A couple friends have said to me, you know, you should run for city council. We have to look at, when we talk about going into politics, we need to know exactly where the knots are, what difference we can make in trying to make it a little differently. And that's why I decided to, maybe not in politics, but why not create a school, you know, an academy of music and arts. And my mission is to develop the students along with their parents and how they look at life. You know, my mission statement is that, you know, they'll be counting notes and not bullets. That's my motto, you know. So a career in politics, I think being on stage delivering messages is very political because you do influence the thought of another person. And some people may not, you know. But you have to always know that once you step into that arena, as you know, they will talk about what color you polish your toes back in 1940. Well, I wasn't born then. But, you know, so am I prepared to do that? That's my least concern, because you can always diffuse whatever. Mm-hmm. But, yes, politics interests me. To run, maybe.
And I gather it's your love for Trenton that has propelled you to come back here after being born and leaving, because Trenton, I did my research. This is actually my first time in Trenton, New Jersey.
It's the capital.
It's my first time. I'm embarrassed to say that, but it is. Mm-hmm. And I did some research, and the reputation of Trenton is not good.
No, in fact, it has hindered my ability to raise funds for my academy. Because no one is looking at the reputation of the city is not that great. Their pants on the ground, you know, we can't blame the kids. We have to start with the policies that were created for the residents of Trenton. My reason for coming back here, to be honest, was not the love of Trenton in the beginning. My reason for coming back here was to protect and establish a more solid ground for my air property. I came back. I didn't count on it, but the house I grew up in was had people in the family living in it, and you know the story, how it goes. And I was not happy with what I saw. There were a lot of issues surrounding the air property. I got here and I started, you know, even in restoring the properties, there were people who were unemployed, some were ex-druggies, alcoholics. I decided to hire these people because I wanted to hear what was going on. And the other thing is that my father always said, if you feed them, they won't steal from you. Mm-hmm. Okay, so everybody was watching what I was doing in these properties. They saw it being excavated, and they were like, can I have this? You can have whatever. And I hired him and come in and do some work. And listening to how they talked about what was going on, I said, I think I'm going to move in this house. Let me see, you know. And different neighbors were coming up. Oh, you're going to make a difference in the neighborhood. I said, really? You know, yes. Okay, I still had my little cane, you know, walking around, and they're like, okay, you know, saw the development as I got stronger, and I said, you know, let me see if I can get a school here. I was given a sum of $100,000, which I gave back because I wasn't in no way prepared to do what I wanted to do. So I gave the money back. But
the $100,000?
For to create a school.
Oh, who gave you that?
It's anonymous.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and I can still go back and get it. You mm-hmm. know, I kept it for a while, but I said, you know what? I'm not going to be the person, you know. And then, you know, Dad had a scrap metal yard. I had to get that all cleaned up. And then being close to my family was another reason why. It was just like, I'll be closer to them. And I, you know, I'm older now. A friend of mine passed. She lived in New York. And her family was in Pittsburgh, I believe. Before they could get to her apartment, people had cleaned it out. It was the most dogged behavior I'd ever witnessed in my life. It actually made me sick. So I said, you know, I'm going to stay right here with my family. I'm going to see who they are after all these years. You know, you're not going to love everyone in your family. You're not going to like everyone, but you know that support, that family support is very important.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so coming back to Trenton was a life force for me. I grew up in another arena. Yeah.
I have to tell you, I am in awe with your new record.
Oh.
And the title, I'm Still Here, is so profound because a lot of other artists have written songs with that title to it. But I think your story in particular, you know, when I really did some in-depth research about Labelle and your career and the ups, the downs, I felt as though there are people in the industry who get the fame and the glory, and then there are people in the industry who deserve to get that and they never do.
Well, it's actually a testimony. I'm Still Here starts out with been through so much in my life. Every day was a different fight. Been down the road of broken dreams, and they told me I was weak. Somehow, I got back on my feet by overcoming my what? My fears. Fear plays a big part in folks' lives. It's okay to feel afraid, but you don't need to be fearful. It's a waste of time. God didn't give us the spirit of fear. He gave us the spirit to fight. He said he didn't say we wouldn't have battles, but he promised us victory.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm Still Here says, you know, in spite of everything that I've been through, take a look and you will see to finally back on my feet. You know, there's no turning back because I'm still here. When I speak in front of these children and I'm speaking to different people about how we can create the Sarah Dash Music and Arts Academy, it's rejection like you've never known. The industry creates rejection. I'm standing in the studio and had prepared to do a song, and folks come in because they got a bigger name and say, oh no, your voice is not good for this. And then walks another person who has a larger name. You know, nobody knows what that feels like Sarah Dash. By the experience of the music industry, it almost wiped me out.
When was this?
Not too long ago. It was the most devastating experience I ever had in my whole entire music career because I was with people that I thought were in my corner. And when I found out that they, every twist, every turn, every... It was the most devastating time. I don't know what their purpose was, but God said no. You know, I put a praying team around me. I mean, I was so devastated that I could not even leave my home, you know. But I put a prayer circle around me. I had different pastors praying for me. And that's why I am, like, right now, I'm like, oh, when I look back, I go, oh, my God, why did you even let that happen? You know, but these are periods of life that one must go through. To have a name in the industry, it's about your work. When I think about the letters that I have that says, oh, thank you for coming to the children's home in San Francisco to speak to the children, the juveniles in D.C. and Virginia, speaking to the kids in Washington, speaking to ladies groups in churches, and sitting with pastors and having pastors as friends, and, you know, knowing different people, you know, that having worked with Keith Richards and Rolling Stones, and you don't get to do that unless you can do it. And those are the things that are important to me, that I was able to do different types of work, you know, singing with Nile Rodgers on his solo CD, the only one that he ever did, I'm singing on it. This is, you know, those are moments that I cherish. And if no one else looks at them as accolades, they're to me because I had the experience. And if you're comparing me to Beyonce or Aretha or even the Patti, you know, I'd be the first to admit I didn't have a PR firm in back of me. I didn't have, there are a lot of things that it takes to make your name to go that way. And I'm just so grateful and so happy that I'm sitting here. I'm still here, you know. Somehow I made it through the night. I prayed and everything was all right, you know, because that's what it takes. It takes prayer. It takes focus. It takes a sense of being grounded. And your spirituality, it comes to you at a certain point without you even knowing. All of a sudden you are sitting back and you're saying, let me think about this. Okay, oh, how is this going to affect me? And then you proceed. When you don't, that first mind, it is always with us, even as we're born. That's the spiritual mind. The first time you think about something, and you don't do it, and you go, God, if I just follow my first thought, develop that in your life, young man, and you will be so far ahead. There were times I didn't listen to my first mind, but I can't blame anybody for that. But this comes with knowledge. And doing my one-woman show, this is what I talk about. I talk about my experiences being a part of different music genres and having, you know, the breakup of the group, Patti Labelle and Bluebelles morphing into Labelle. And that's what my one-woman show says. You know,
mm-hmm. Talk about that. It's playing in New York now.
It's playing in New York, where they are once a month from February straight to May. I just found you heard it at the same time I did today.
And I'm going to come see it.
Yes, we're doing it. It's a biographical musical. And some people that didn't know that I have the ability to sing the blues, I sing jazz, and I do Labelle medley. I do gospel in the show. It's a show that anyone can come and see. I don't curse in it. There's no, you know, no lewd acts being performed. and it's in development. You know, it's really a good piece if you want to know about history, which includes Patti, the Supremes, you know, Murray the K. It's a historical, sort of back-in-the-day musical piece, but it's genuine. It's not, I'm going to sing their songs, but I have the heartbeat in it, you know, mm-hmm. what I mean? Because I lived it, and it's part of my life, you know.
Well, I'm going to come check it out.
Please come and check it out.
And you can find more about that on your website.
On my website, yes.
And I'm going to provide a link to that.
And also Spin Cycle, which is the Laurie Beachman Theater in New York. Yeah.
Okay. Well, I'm curious to see what else you're going to be doing, and I'm sure other people are as well.
Yeah.
Again, I'm so honored that you took the time out.
And well, the next big thing, as I said, is to find the funding for the school, mm-hmm. get the academy. I'm a member of the New Jersey Arts and Art Pride and all that. So from time to time, I will involve myself. I'm a volunteer for the MS Foundation. I'm a member of the Now Group. I'm a member of the Fortune Leadership Membership Council. I'm part
of. You do everything.
Yes, and I'm also a top lady, which I've been inducted this year. Top Ladies of Distinction. It's an organization of 5,000 women across the nation. Only 5,000, And it's an organization that Lady Bird Johnson started back when her husband was president. And I feel really honored to be a top lady because most of these women are like, they have PhDs and things like that. But apparently my intellect meant something. But I was inducted into that organization this year, which is really, and also, I forgot to mention this, I'm on the board of governors for the Grammys. Yes.
Wow.
Yes, elected. And I'm in my second term. So what else can I think about? There are a lot of things. When you said political, that went past my head. I totally forgot about that. But yes, I'm on the board in the Philadelphia chapter.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool. So we'll keep in touch with whatever you're doing. And
yes.
I'm sure people are going to be curious as to what you do next.
Yes.
So thank you for accommodating me. I was happy to come down to Trenton, New Jersey.
Yes, in the studio 7A.
Yeah, this is an amazing place, and a lot of stuff happens here, and you've recorded a lot of things here.
Yes,
so.
And in the back there's a garage where I rehearse. You know, you go out the door, and back there is like, you know, it's a wonderful space. Scott is a wonderful person. And, you know, having a team around me is so important. We call ourselves Team Dash. And we move with precision as much as we can.
Well, I'm looking forward to whatever you're doing. I'm coming to the One Woman Show.
I'm going to hold you to that.
I will be there. It's okay. Right around the corner, so I'm happy to come. And again, I have to thank you.
I thank you for wanting to know what's going on with a person like me.
I've been through so much in my life. Every day, a different fight. Been down the road of broken dreams. They told me I was weak. Somehow I got back on my feet by overcoming my fears. I survived through the worst of times. Take a look at me.
Thank you for listening. This is Roy Paul for WNSR New School Radio.